holographic artifacts from ancient times. So I want to let you consider this for a moment. I'm proposing the existence of ancient holograms. So try to imagine it. Real, actual, literal artifacts from, say, ancient Egypt or China, or maybe even an ancient Mayan hologram. What do you think? Possible? Not possible? So before we get into it, let's define some terms. What exactly is a hologram? So the dictionary definition, a photograph of an interference pattern which, when suitably illuminated, produces a three-dimensional image. Maybe that's not so helpful. Let's take a look at a closer look at what a hologram looks like.
This is a hologram. Holograms have little in common with traditional photographs, except that both use film. Holograms can create completely three-dimensional pictures, and every piece of the film can reconstruct the entire image.
So this is a radically different kind of image.
Can project the entire image.
So what he's doing here is he has punched out just a tiny piece of the hologram, and now he's shining a laser through that tiny little piece of hologram, and it's projecting the entire image.
Here is a two-channel hologram. Two scenes have been recorded at different angles on the film. The channel is selected by tilting the film. The lens in the holographic reconstruction actually works.
So the takeaway here is I wanted you to get a sense that we're talking about a radically different kind of image. Not only is this a medium which is capable of recording three-dimensional images, but in certain instances, the hologram actually functions like a real object. So a hologram of a lens actually works as a lens. So now you may be thinking, okay, how could a hologram have been invented earlier? In order to make a hologram, you need lasers, you need modern photographic film, not to mention a conception of wave properties of light. So hold on to those thoughts. Let's talk a little bit about what a hologram is made of. A hologram is made on the same basic material as a photograph. It's recorded on an ultra fine grain, light sensitive film. So the takeaway here is it's not what the hologram is made of that makes the hologram special. The only real difference between a hologram and a photograph is the way the image is structured on the film. Now, we don't usually think about the way images are structured, and perhaps this is because most of the images humans make have the same basic fundamental structure. So from the most ancient cave paintings to almost any image that you can think of today, we make images by distributing pigments on a surface. Pigments or colors, you know, distributed, projected onto a surface. So here we have pigments that were sprayed from the mouth to trace the outline of a hand on a rock wall of a cave. Over time, we've invented new pigments, and we've applied them to different surfaces, and we've invented fancier ways of applying and ordering the distribution of those pigments. But fundamentally, it's remained the same. So here, with the emergence of linear perspective in the Renaissance, artists were able to create images with a startling illusion of depth. This, combined with access to a wide range of pigments, allowed for increasingly lifelike images. So, but still, the essential structure of the image remained largely the same, pigments on a surface. In the 19th century, an even fancier technique emerged for distributing pigments on a surface, photography. So the so-called pencil of nature, photography rendered images automatically in perfect perspective. But still, we have this fundamental structure that remains unchanged. So to bring this back around, most all of human image making shares this fundamental structure. For example, let's compare a photograph and a drawing. Any photograph can be traced and made into a drawing. And with sufficient skill, it can be copied exactly in a drawing such that the drawing is indistinguishable from the photograph. It works the other way too. A photograph of a drawing can reproduce that drawing exactly. And this is possible because they share the same basic structure. But what is the structure of a hologram? If we were to zoom into a hologram, we would see tiny wave interference patterns, which function like microscopic lenses or mirrors. These microscopic elements bear no recognizable relationship to the holographic image depicted. It is as if the individual parts of the hologram, its brushstroke or pixel, if you will, exists in an entirely different domain, another dimension entirely from the whole image which they represent. So the more I understood about holography, the more perplexed I became. I studied the physics of the hologram, and I could carry out the technical steps to make one. But basically, I started to formulate this question. It struck me as odd that clearly the structure of the hologram bears much more resemblance to the subject than other forms of image making. So, for example, whereas an image, like a drawing, may have almost nothing to do with its subject. I don't know what happened there. That's okay. There's something interesting about the fact that we find something like drawing entirely intuitive, and yet the structure of the hologram we find alien and non-intuitive, but the hologram actually physically and mathematically has a lot more to do with the object that it represents. So I found this odd, and I began to wonder, what would it take to gain an intuitive understanding of the hologram? And I began to imagine being able to sketch a hologram the way that you can freely sketch with a pencil on paper. Related to that, what would the understanding look like? What would it be like to have a holographic perspective? So from here, I began to wonder, how could we trace a hologram? In other words, photography is to drawing as holography is to what? So this question began what would be a many years long quest to develop a complete system of holographic drawing. So this would normally be the subject of an entire talk. But in the interest of time, I'm just going to relate one particular story of special significance to our topic today. So this is the story of a chance observation. It's the early 1990s, and a man named William Beatty is walking through a parking lot. Beatty notices a glint of light reflected from the sun on the hood of a car, and he notices that it appears to hover as if several inches above the hood surface. On closer inspection, Beatty is surprised to discover that this floating glint of light is in the shape of a human hand. And furthermore, the hood is covered with glowing hands, some appearing above and some as if below the surface of the hood, but all made up of reflected light. Beatty realizes that someone had accidentally polished their car with a gritty rag, creating just the right pattern of micro scratches on the hood surface to reflect and focus light into a crude holographic image of their own hand. So Beatty did what anyone would do in this circumstance. He went directly home and polished his car with sandpaper. So after some experimentation, Beatty devised a system to create crude holograms by scratching a reflective surface with nothing other than a ruler and compass, drawing tools known since before the time of Euclid. It turns out that others have noticed this phenomenon. In my research, I have discovered numerous artists, scientists, and inventors who noticed and commented on similar effects, including probably many of you. Have you ever driven at night and noticed streaks of light formed by the smudges left from your windshield wipers on the glass? You were seeing an abrasion hologram. This is the same basic effect as Beatty's hands. So next time you see this, if you look closely, you will discover that these ropes of light have a striking 3D effect, appearing to extend back into space towards the position of each passing streetlight. So over many years, I built on this basic optical effect, perfecting my own complete system for drawing holograms by hand, an intuitive holographic perspective. So here are some of my hand-drawn holograms on display at LACMA. These were made using custom diamond tools, which I fashioned myself. Each image is made up of light focused by precisely oriented micro-reflectors engraved by hand on a metal disc. Of course, you cannot fully appreciate the three-dimensional illusion on screen here today, but hopefully you can see in the video that the holograms appear fully as if dimensional shapes hovering several inches above the disc. So let's return to our initial question of ancient holograms. Why haven't we discovered holographic artifacts from ancient times? Perhaps now it doesn't sound quite so far-fetched to imagine ancient holograms. As we've learned, we don't need lasers or modern film or even a wave theory of light. All that is required to make a simple hologram is the technology to polish metal to a mirror finish and some klutz to wipe it with a dirty rag. And if an ancient hologram was made, would we notice? Just think of it, an ancient bronze mirror with the magic image of a hand blazing in the sun. How would the ancient mind have understood this vision? And would we ever be able to recognize such an artifact if we found it, tarnished and dulled over the ages? Okay. I know some of you in the audience may still be not convinced. You're thinking, okay, sure, but really we're not going to find an ancient hologram. So I'm going to share one last thing for you to consider. I was very excited this summer to come across this article. Curators discover a rare Chinese magic mirror, one of the only known in the West, in the depths of the Cincinnati Art Museum storage. The magic mirror was for years believed to be an unassuming bronze disc. So the so-called magic mirror was first created in China during the Han Dynasty, beginning around 200 BCE. So you can see here what appears to be just a regular polished bronze disc actually has micro distortions in its surface, invisible until light is reflected off the mirror in the right way, and an image is magically projected on the wall. Here you can see the light directed at the mirror and its projection, and here's a detail of the projection. In this case, it's an image of Amitabha Buddha. So maybe this is as close as we're ever going to get to finding an actual ancient hologram, but I, for one, am still holding out. Okay, so speculative vision number two, a cameraless camera. So the word camera comes from the Latin camera obscura, which literally means dark room or dark chamber. And that's exactly what the camera is. It's a dark box with a hole in it. What I'm proposing here is a camera without the box or the hole, or for that matter, a lens, a cameraless camera. So most of you are probably familiar with the basic structure of the camera, but let's open it up and look at a cross-section. Light enters the lens to form an image at the back of the camera, where it can be captured by film or a digital sensor. Here, we can clearly see the light-tight box, which is central to the camera. Every camera from the earliest camera obscura to the iPhone camera in your pocket shares the same basic structure. It's a dark box with a hole in it. But what does the dark chamber of the camera body actually do? Well, it blocks all the other rays of light so that the only light that can enter the camera comes through the hole, through the lens. But what if we could make a surface, a filter or a screen that could block the light in the same way? Such a filter would be placed directly in front of the film, and the dark chamber would no longer be required. So to this end, I conceived of an array of holes, all oriented towards a common focal point. Such an array would block all light from passing through the filter, except for those light rays which come from this one position in space, just like we have in the camera with the lens. But how could we make such an array? So my first attempt employed a crude device. A metal rod with a needle affixed to its end is passed through a hole in a wooden fixture. And you can see a black foam core sheet is attached below. This arrangement allows the needle to move freely up and down and to pivot within the hole. So you can kind of imagine this freedom to move around. And as I'm poking holes in this black foam core sheet, any of the holes are oriented so that they point back towards that upper pivot point in the wooden fixture. So this first experiment was just enough to convince me that I needed a more precise device. So I machined a metal gimbal, which is basically a universal joint that allows the needle shaft to slide and pivot more precisely. And again, here you can see the arrangement. And you can imagine that this shaft can move all around, and any hole that's poked in the surface below would be pointing towards that gimbal hinge up in space. So here you can see the process of poking holes into the foam core sheet by hand. This was a very painstaking process, and I think I almost gave myself a repetitive stress injury doing this. But over the course of many days, or weeks actually, I completely covered this sheet with holes, all again, pointing towards that focal point in space. So here's the completed pinhole array. And in this video, I'm just holding it up in front of a white wall. And I don't know if you can see clearly in this video, but there's a subtle ball of light that appears to be hovering behind the foam core sheet. This is the focal point. And you can see that the holes are blocking all light except that which passes through this one point in 3D space. So now we have our pinhole array. And as I just described, it blocks all light except that which passes through that particular point in space. And if we return now to our camera, we can imagine placing the pinhole array in front of our film plane. And we can see now that we no longer need the bellows or the front standard. In fact, we can do away with the dark chamber of the camera entirely. So if we place a lens at the focal point of this pinhole array, we have a bodiless camera, an optical system without the standard camera obscura, the dark chamber that has been in every camera since the beginning of photography. So this sounds good in theory, but will it actually work? So here's the prototype that I built. You can see my pinhole array here, and the pinhole array only allows light to reach the film through a point in space aligned with the lens. And you can see, so here's our, to make it clear, here's again our traditional bellows camera. And if we overlay it with our bodiless, cameraless camera, we have this bizarre camera without the dark chamber between the lens and the film. Here we are looking at the camera from the backside. You can see the film is attached to the back of the pinhole screen with black plastic so that light can't reach it from behind. And moment of truth, so here's one of the first testing, and I don't know if you can make that out. There's a crude image there of a train bridge. So this is kind of a proof of concept. We have our cameraless camera. You know, I thought this was pretty exciting for a prototype made with just poking a needle tool into a piece of foam core sheet. But let's return to the original speculative question. I asked, can we build a camera without a body or a lens? We still need a lens here, don't we? Now, to remove the lens, we need only to make the precision of the pinhole array finer. So again, I poked these holes by hand using a needle tool. If the precision of the array could be made fine enough, it could theoretically focus light to a point the size of a pinhole, making it actually act as a pinhole lens. So that would be our, in that case, we could remove our lens entirely, and this object would function as a truly cameraless camera. Okay, so speculative vision number three, glacial optics. So here I'm asking, could the ice of the glacier function as a giant lens? So what I'm proposing here is I'm positing the glacier perched on mountaintops and in the furthest polar climes as natural optical elements, giant lenses compacted under the weight of eons and polished by wind and snow. So to start with, let me give you a bit more information about glacial ice. Glacial ice can be extremely clear. In fact, under the right conditions, it's the most clear substance found in nature. More clear even than diamond. Scientists drill deep into the glaciers, extracting cores of ice, which record detailed information about our climate past. Some of the oldest ice discovered in Antarctica is between 4 and 5 million years old. I first began experimenting with making lenses out of ice while artist in residence at the Exploratorium in San Francisco. And I immediately began to imagine the glacier as offering the possibility of making not just a literal lens, but a metaphorical one through which to understand ourselves and the world in these times of unmitigated climate disaster. As I learned more about the science of ice cores, I became fascinated with the temporal dimension of these cores and the idea of making lenses from a particular strata in time. So, how do you go about making a lens out of ice? It turns out there's no readily available software designed to make ice lenses of precise focal lengths, so I had to make one. So here, using Snell's law and the refractive index of ice, I made a custom optical simulator for designing my ice lenses. Here, I'm using what's called a simulated annealing solver to find the optimal lens curvature for a target focal length while minimizing spherical aberration. And the irony is not lost on me here. Going to such lengths to design a perfect lens, which will be made in this inherently imprecise material of a melting chunk of ice. Next, I machined special dies for forming the ice into the desired lens curvatures. So the, turn that off. So the lenses form, the lens forming dyes work actually by melting the ice into the shape of the lens. So I start by heating the metal dyes, and then I place a chunk of clear ice in between the two parts, and as it melts down, the lens shape is formed. So attaching this slippery, wet, melting lens to a camera presented a unique challenge. I employed a system using elastic bands to suspend the lens. So as the ice lens melts and shrinks, the elastic keeps the lens centered in the optical axis. It's quite interesting to notice the curvature of the lens actually remains fairly consistent as it melts. So the lens continues to function even until it, just before it drips out of the lens. That was quite an exciting discovery. So here's a more advanced version of the elastic fixture. The individual bands are replaced with a tube of black elastic fabric made from nylon stockings. So when it's twisted, the fabric cinches around the ice and forms a light, tight elastic holder. So here's the ice lens mounted in the elastic holder and affixed to a tent camera. So this camera is designed to shoot up to 4 by 8 foot negatives. This is outside my studio in LA testing. So I operate the camera from the inside. So notice the air bubbles in the lens. Here I was testing how many air bubbles and other imperfections I could get away with. And as you can see, the image is surprisingly sharp for a lens made out of such imperfect ice. And again, that's about an 8 foot wide image that's being projected on the back of the tent there. So in April of this year, I mounted an expedition to the Arctic with my ice lens camera and tools for shaping the ice. I went in search of glacier ice clear enough to make lenses. And my idea was to capture portraits of the glacier focused through their very own ice. The journey was not without hardships. Traveling on a three-masted tall ship, we were beset with storms and delays. And while crossing the Barents Sea, COVID struck. We became a literal plague ship with something like 80% of the entire ship crew coming down with COVID. But that's a longer story for another time. To make the long story short, we did finally arrive at the long-sought glaciers. And it's hard to capture the scale here, but what you're seeing here, this is a wall of glacier ice rising out of the sea several stories tall and over a mile wide. It's a truly humbling thing to see. And I did manage to find perfect crystal clear glacier ice. So now I should mention here, I didn't actually know if I would be able to find ice clear enough to make lenses before going. So I had talked to numerous glacial scientists and people familiar with this landscape, and none of them could answer this question because it's not something that people usually think about as it's other properties of ice that these scientists are often looking at. And there's also a certain element of chance. The ice that you find floating around has calved off of glaciers. And so depending on how old the ice is and how deep in the glacier, you might get lucky and just find some really clear ancient ice. So here it's on the ship using my heated dyes to form a lens blank. And shaping it into the curvature and putting it in the fixture. You can see that I was able to find some pretty incredibly clear ice. So here's assembling the tent camera, mounting the lens, and focusing the image. And you can kind of see the image behind me there. (Laughter) So, yeah, here's the tent camera on the ice. And these are my giant rolls of film. So this expedition was quite physically challenging. Some of the harshest conditions imaginable. Plus, every day I was hauling over 150 pounds of equipment out onto the ice to try to capture shots. So this is back at my studio drying one of the freshly developed giant negatives. And just to give you a little sense, here's some of the prints coming out. And again, the negatives are, they're contact printed. So it's a one-to-one printing process. This is an 8-foot-wide print. Just to give you a sense of some of the other images shot through the glacier lens. So this is actually shot and focused through a chunk of ice found in the Arctic. So let's return to the original speculative vision of glacial optics. Now, I know some of you are probably thinking, I laid out this idea of, here I've described making a lens out of ice, but that's not quite using the entire glacier as some kind of primordial lens. But to close this section, I'd like to share something else. So pictured here is the Ice Cube Neutrino Observatory in Antarctica. So beneath this building are sensors embedded in a cubic kilometer of perfectly optically clear glacier ice. So here's a cutaway schematic view of the sensors. And you can see up at the very top there, if you see my cursor, that's that tiny little structure, that's the building that we were looking at in the last photo. So the building is really just a place to compile all of the data collected from these sensors. So quite literally, this observatory uses the glacier as a massive optical element to form a picture of the cosmos. So perhaps our vision of a primordial glacial lens is now not really so far-fetched after all. Okay, so our fourth and final speculative vision, number 4, is primordial photography. Is life a prerequisite for a photograph to occur? So here I'm positing the idea of a primordial photograph, a picture without a maker, like a photochemical fossil, wherein chemical reactions and optical conditions align by chance to form a naturally occurring photograph. So first I'd like to introduce two other artists, Lauren Bonn and Richard Nielsen. Together in 2010, we formed the Optics Division of the Metabolic Studio, a collaborative project devoted to exploring experimental photography. Now, there's a lot more to my work with Rich and Lauren in the Optics Division than I have time to go into here. And again, this would normally be the topic of a whole separate presentation. But for today, I'm just going to touch on some of the investigations which relate to our speculative line of inquiry here. So in one of our ongoing projects, we have sought to reinvent photography as a land-based practice. So what exactly does that mean? We set out to try and make a photograph of the landscape made entirely out of that landscape. So one landscape in particular became the focus of this work, and that's the Owens Valley, about 250 miles north of Los Angeles. This is a very important site in the history and present moment of Los Angeles. LA still gets close to 40% of its drinking water from the Owens Valley. And as a result, the once massive Owens Lake has become a dry lake bed. So the map you see here shows the historic shoreline of the Owens Lake. So this artificially accelerated desiccation of the lake bed has created an environmental disaster. So with extremely high levels of fine particulate and carcinogenic dust blowing off the lake bed. The valley also has a history of silver mining and other extractive industry, which has left a legacy of pollution. So it was in this place that we set out to try and make a photograph of the landscape entirely made out of this landscape. So to get started, we need to know, what is a photograph made of? What are the basic ingredients? Most photographic film is made from three things: silver, a halogen, and gelatin. So basically, film is a distribution of crystals made from silver and a halogen suspended in an animal gelatin. So to begin with, we set out in search of silver. Here you can see actually the Owens Dry Lake bed in the valley below. The Owens Valley is home to the historic Cerro Gordo silver mine, operational from the 1860s to the 1930s. It was once California's largest producer of silver. We rehabilitated the historic lift to this mine using the original dynamo and steel cable. So this video shows our first descent into the 900-foot vertical shaft. So, having collected silver ore, it must be refined to remove lead and other impurities. Here, ore is being smelted in a bone crucible. The next ingredient we need to make film is a halogen salt. And luckily, the lake bed is a plentiful source of chloride salt. So chlorine is one of the halogens. Notice the pink salt visible beneath the upper salt crust. This is something we're going to return to in a moment. But we have our salt. And we have gelatin. So as it happens, the Owens Valley is a ranching community. So we were able to source bones from local cattle. And I'm summarizing here to give you, basically, this is the end result. Having collected all of our ingredients, we're able to make our light-sensitive emulsion. And this here is a photograph of the Cerro Gordo mine made entirely out of materials sourced from the Owens Valley. But what I really want to talk about here today is our discovery of what happens to be a naturally occurring photochemical brine pool in the middle of the Owens Dry Lake bed. So the white and pink surface you see here is a thin crust of salt, which covers a concentrated thiosulfate brine teeming with extremophile bacteria. It's the bacteria which give this pool its blood red color. It's hypersaline, highly caustic, and we discovered highly effective at processing film. So up to this point, we had sought to extract and isolate compounds and recreate traditional photographic materials back in our lab. But now we saw the opportunity for something else, a photography truly of the landscape. So our lake bed developing process was born. And basically, we go out to the lake bed on a moonless night. We use the night as our darkroom. Here we are burying prints in the brine, and we're using our red headlamps as safe lights. This is a natural process which varies with the seasons depending on temperature and rainfall, and we'll get dramatically different results. This process is linked to the natural systems of the landscape. So the next morning, we return to dig up the prints. And this is what it looks like some strange shallow graves. So I want to say here, we're outside the paradigm of standard photographic processes of developer, stop, and fix. The lake bed reacts with the film in kind of rogue, unexpected ways, rendering prints with iridescent colors, swirls of ochre and metallic tones, sometimes even mirror-like tones. The Owens lakebed is also a highly human impacted environment. So my collaborator, Lauren Bond, likes to call it a cyborg watershed. Due to the carcinogenic dust, the LA Department of Water and Power was court ordered to implement dust control measures. So the entire lakebed is a network of pipes and valves. In fact, the shallow water levels in these brine pools where we develop our film are maintained by the LADWP as part of their dust mitigation program. It's estimated that LADWP has spent about $2.5 billion on dust mitigation in the Owens lakebed. So we like to say that this is our $2.5 billion darkroom. They even built us this convenient washing station for washing our prints. So just to give you an idea of some of the varied results, it's hard to see the detail here, but the entire image is covered with this sort of fractured, cracked salt formation of pink colors. Here you see swirls of ochre tones. So to kind of wrap this all up, let's return to this idea of primordial photography. And the question, is life a prerequisite for photography? And here I'd like to actually turn this original question on its head a bit. So it just so happens that exoplanetary biologists are studying the very same brine pools that we are using for our lakebed developing process. The Owens lakebed could be thought of as a kind of Mars analog environment. Extremophile bacteria, such as those found in our brine pools, can survive in extreme conditions and may offer insight into what life on another planet could look like. Our current working theory is that the extremophile bacteria living in these pools are metabolizing sulfur, producing various unstable compounds which oxidize quite readily and would not otherwise be found in nature. So, or at least in such high quantities. So this has another really interesting connection to exoplanetary biology. Scientists are searching for ways to identify life empirically. So if you send a probe to Mars looking for life, what could you measure that would indicate life? And one answer is to look for compounds that shouldn't be there. In other words, accumulations of some substance that could only be explained by the presence of a living metabolic process. So in a similar way, our photographic process actually functions like an indicator of life, detecting high levels of sodium thiosulfate and other reactive compounds, which should not be there in an inert system. So having started out with a vision of a primordial photography, which is lifeless, inert, with no maker, instead we have hit upon what is perhaps an even more tantalizing speculation, that the primordial soup, that theoretical progenitor of life, may actually be teeming with photochemical potential, a living, breathing, metabolizing developer.
And I believe we have a few minutes for questions.
Hi, that was really mind-blowing. I had a question about this very interesting point you made about the non-intuitiveness of the hologram and how you, if I understand it, and forgive me if I'm wrong about this, you became quite adept at sort of etching on these mirrors with the resultant holograms. So yes. I'm just sort of curious, if I may ask you, when you etch, and you know what the consequence of the etching is going to be in terms of the hologram. What is it? Is it just something where you go to sort of said to yourself, I want a hexagon or something, and then you just, your hand sort of began to just do it? Or were you still visualizing even when you were good at the moment of etching? Do you see what I'm asking?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, it's a great question. And the way that I would describe it is that with linear perspective, so there's two ways that I could go about making an image, right? I could actually use a ruler and get precise, and I could plot out a vanishing point. I'm talking normal drawing here. I could plot out a vanishing point, and I could draw, say, a cube in really perfect perspective, and it would be, you know, a really kind of convincing illusion of three-dimensional depth. Or if I've done that enough times, I could also just kind of freehand draw a cube, and it might, depending on how good I am, it might look pretty much like a cube, but it might not be so precise. So in a similar way, I've developed geometric rules which form a holographic perspective. And if I want to be precise, it's very geometric. I can use a ruler and a compass, and I can map out exactly, precisely what I want to create. But in a similar way to normal drawing, I can also, having done this enough and internalized it, you know, I could just sit down and do a freehand version of the same drawing that would be pretty close. And maybe to answer a little bit more in detail what your question was, the biggest difference, the thing that I find fascinating about drawing holograms is that it requires you not to, instead of thinking about one perspective, you're thinking about a full 360 degrees of vantage points around an object. So you no longer are thinking of one privileged point of view, you're thinking of all points of view. And so this is a really radically mind-bendingly different way of thinking about an image. And that's really in the beginning of this quest, that's what I was looking for, was to try to find a vehicle for finding an intuitive way of understanding the whole image of the hologram. And so I hopefully that answers your question.
Really lovely talk, very inspiring. So I want to ask a really ridiculous question. Could you imagine, so I think you've convinced me that photography can predate biology, right? Mm. So could you imagine conditions on Earth or any planetary body where there might be a coincidence of a material that can act like a focusing medium and then the right conditions to capture that light and therefore, and that photographic fossil be preserved?
Sure. Yeah.
And maybe even speculate about things we might want to go and look for to understand or the actual planet, I mean, I don't know, looked like, but felt like chemically, I don't know. This sounds a bit weird.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think it's quite possible. It could happen in the form of, you know, a cave with, you know, a pinhole, a small aperture can operate as a lens. So we can quite easily imagine sort of a cave-like opening with some kind of mineral deposits of silver salts forming and then, you know, light recording some kind of image. It's possible. I don't know how likely, but it's possible. I mean, the other possibility would be the idea of a photogram, you know, something like a sun print where, you know, a light sensitive material could be covered, occluded by objects, and then a shadow is captured. And we actually see this all the time, like in a house where a painting has been hung or furniture has been sitting against a wall for decades, and then we move the furniture, we'll find that the paint has faded around, you know, around the objects, and you get this sort of naturally occurring photogram, if you will.
One more question. Anybody else? Right up here.
So this may be a vague question, but I guess you're familiar with some of the concept of the black hole being a holographic membrane.
Sure.
We're talking about natural phenomena. Is that something you can talk about?
Yeah, I mean, probably that's a little outside the scope of what we can get into here today, but, you know, it's a very interesting idea, and, you know, my understanding is that this is basically, this idea of a holographic universe comes from essentially this, what the math shows us is that the the surface, sort of the event horizon, or the surface boundary of the black hole, in fact, determines the limit of how much information can be stored inside of that volume. So that's kind of a surprising discovery, if you think about it, because imagine like a spherical volume of space, you would expect that it would be the area that would determine how much information could be packed into that space. But it's not true. It actually turns out it's the surface. And so this has led to some ideas about that maybe there's a structure that underlies our universe that is in fact holographic, in the sense that information can be encoded on a surface, but then refer to or in another domain actually present information that's dimensional. I think it's a fascinating idea.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everybody.